first giving honor to God, pastor of this great church.
Amen.
Who truly is a friend.
Yes.
To the clergy and the Catechizing and Ordination Council I've just met, and you're my friends too.
Amen. Thank you.
I bless the Lord for it.
Amen.
It's good to be among Christians.
Amen.
We are strangers, but one time.
Mm-hmm.
And after we say we're Christians, we're all in the family of God.
Amen.
And, I'm just grateful to be here. My wife and I are here from San Antonio, Texas. Pastor of the Bethany First Baptist Church. I've been pastor for, this is the 32nd year.
Bless you. Amen.
Amen. I want my wife to stand. She's here.
Amen.
Amen. I wouldn't be anywhere I am.
What you say?
If it wasn't for that lady.
Thank you, Lord.
All right.
Thank you, Lord.
Now I want to do something, just a little departure here from the seating arrangements. I want Sister Dorothy to come and join. You'll get on the second row here.
Amen.
You're out of the hot seat now. I want you all to get this together. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And look, come on, the whole family. Amen.
Amen.
Because the next destination God has for you is a family destination. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Just on the second seat, sweetheart. Amen. There you go. I won't put you on that first seat. That's a little too close. Yeah. We want to thank God, and certainly I don't want to be long, but as we say, long enough.
Amen.
It'd be a shame to turn you out too early and say, I thought they was preaching that. Ain't nobody preach that quick. But I want to preach just enough to say what God has to say.
Amen.
And certainly I want to thank Pastor Hawkins for letting me have the privilege of coming to preach. Amen.
Amen.
That's a loving pastor. That's a generous pastor.
Amen.
Amen. Give him a hand.
Amen.
Amen. I promise I won't be long, but I'll be long enough. And almost brought me to tears when he talked about seeing me in a vision and a dream. And I had some hair back then. But the Lord is gracious.
Amen.
Merciful and lendeth his spirit.
Yes, sir.
I want to take us back to this charge that Paul gave Timothy as the most relevant passage of scripture one can give a preacher starting out. Amen?
Amen.
And it is the charge. It is something that you keep before you. And it is the language of the gospel as Paul would write to Timothy these words from the book of 2 Timothy chapter 4. You are familiar with it. He writes here, I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. Preach the word, be diligent, in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort with all long suffering. Why do that? He says, for the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lusts shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. Now the advice he gives you there, he says, and they shall turn away, and he says, and they shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned unto fables. But watch thou in all things, endure affliction, do the work of an evangelist, and make full proof of thy ministry. Father, we thank you now for the power and efficacy of your word, for the calling of Reverend Hatfield and the ordination. And Lord, as we go through the process, we all are reminded how much this is a big and important task to you. How much it is preeminent in our lives and how much it is the very first mission of our life. Every breath we take, every step we make is toward the fulfillment of making full proof of the ministry of the calling of God.
Yes.
And Lord, we are not ashamed of the salvation of God, but it's the power of God.
Hallelujah.
The salvation. We thank you for the anointing. Because that anointing is something you give. And we say amen to it. And we thank you now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you. We want to talk just for a little while. Preach the word. Preach the word.
Preach
the word. Paul writes to Timothy because Timothy was, like we all are, somewhat timid. Timothy had a timidity about himself, and he was a young man.
Yeah.
And being a young man, you don't want to overstep the senior man.
Yeah.
You better careful, and they'll let you know when you overstep a woman. So the timidity was well-founded. But he has to tell him, now listen, Timothy, I don't want you to be timid when it comes to the word. Because the word you have was instructed from Lois and Eunice, and you were raised on the gospel. And when it's time to tell them the gospel, don't you bite your tongue, you tell them the truth. Tell them the truth. And so he comes to this point of preaching the word. Now I want to say, let the peas work for you. And if you were cooking, I say, let the peas work for you. The P's I'm talking about, prayer and preaching. When your preaching is in a slump, pray more. When your prayer is in a slump, preach more. But let the P's work for you. There's a dynamic process of reciprocity that when you pray, you can preach. And when you preach, you can show up. Let the P's work for you. Amen? Now he says, preach what? Preach the word.
Okay.
Now there are a lot of things people want to preach.
Wow.
They want to preach think and grow rich.
Wow.
They want to preach all kinds of things.
Wow.
And all kinds of materialistic things.
Yeah.
And they don't want to preach the gospel anymore.
Wow.
Just tell you how to be motivated.
Wow.
I said, we're not motivational speakers. We're preachers. We're not preaching. Just be happy and go to church and don't say nothing.
Wow.
We got to tell them about the fires of hell. Sin, but the gift of God is eternal life through.
You're preaching.
You're preaching the word. Come to church and hear some little dandelion story. Listen, I'm hurting. You got to tell me where it hurts and what to do and get some help when it hurts. Preach the word. And if you preach the word, you preach the word of God. That word that can cause men to live. That word that can transform lives.
Yes.
When God got Ezekiel ready to preach,
he
took him to the valley. He said it was a valley of pride. And the Lord put him under divine interrogation. God asked the question. Then he said, can these bones live? That was the question Ezekiel had. Somebody said, like a prize fighter, he didn't want to get out there too quick. He didn't want to jump out there with that question from God. And he said, I thought about it. He said, well, if I answer too quickly, I cast doubt on myself. Because I don't know if I can believe if dead things can live. But yet if I say no, then I doubt the veracity in God. For God knows all things. So he did what somebody called a putback. He said, thou knowest all. As for me, I don't know if my bones can live. But if I know. And God said, get up and preach. Preach that word. Preach unto the Bible. Say, oh, hear ye your dry bones. Hear the word of the Lord. When the dry bones heard, they said bones went to connecting the bone. They were shaking, rattling, and rolling. And God put up a great army. Then he preached to the sinew that the flesh came upon them. Then he preached to the four winds and breath came upon them. And they stood glistening in armor and they stood with banners flapping in the wind in representation. All things can live if you preach the word. That word. Somebody said, as James Rutland Johnson put it, and God stepped out on space. And it was blacker than 100 midnights. Down in a cypress swamp. Then God smiled. And the light broke. And the darkness rolled up on one side. And the light stood shining on the other. And God said, that's good. Preach that word. Preach that word that says, in the beginning was the word. And the word was with God.
Yeah.
And the word was God.
Yeah.
When God said he stepped out on space, somebody said it was a divine decathlon.
Yeah.
A 10, let there be.
Yeah.
And God stepped out and said, let there be, let there be, let there be,
yeah.
let there be. And like a symphony, it came, and it was so, and it was so, and it was so. Word of God.
Yeah.
For Jesus says, I am the Alpha and the Omega,
yeah.
the beginning and the end.
Yeah.
I am the alphabet,
yeah.
the living alphabet.
Yeah.
And the word searches the mind of God
yeah.
so that it knows what is conceived.
Yeah.
So Jesus is the conceived word.
Yeah.
He is the spoken word.
Yeah.
And when he comes out, he's the revealed word.
Yeah.
And the Bible says, and the word became flesh,
yeah.
which means the word, came on down to earth,
yeah.
and though he was not able to be seen,
yeah.
when he rose up, he was the word with skin on.
Yeah.
He was the Son of God.
Word, word.
Hallelujah.
Preach the word.
Yeah.
Don't equivocate.
Nah.
Why don't equivocate? He says, do this. And be instant in season
yeah.
and out of season.
That's right.
This is a strange season in America.
Amen.
People have gone out of their mind.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
They have left God
uh-huh. yes.
and gone after the world.
Yes.
You gotta stand your ground.
Yeah.
We got situations now that want to endorse
yes.
same-sex marriage.
Wow.
Can I speak that right here?
Yeah.
God ain't never said nothing about same-sex marriage except it's wrong.
Yeah.
We got it.
Yes, sir.
That's out of, that's gonna be in season always.
Well,
it's wrong now.
Yeah.
It'll be wrong tomorrow.
Yeah.
When Jesus come back,
yeah.
it'll be wrong now.
Yeah.
Do not let the power of persuasion take you away
yeah.
from the word of God.
Yeah.
It'll be popular.
Yeah.
It'll be politically correct.
Yeah.
But it'll be wrong.
Yeah.
As true as president say
right,
it still don't square
yeah.
with the word of God.
Amen.
Be instant in season
yeah.
and out of season.
Amen.
I don't care if your little children have to see your parent children who have of the same sex marriage. That does not change the word of God.
Yeah.
That's not reason enough to vacillate, equivocate, oscillate,
yeah.
and prevaricate.
Yeah.
Stand
yeah.
on the word.
Yeah.
And when they don't want to hear, stand in it. I have a motion. You say it wrong.
Yeah.
If it ain't right, it ain't gonna be right. I don't care what you say.
Yeah.
You gotta stand like that.
Yeah.
If you don't stand like that, that's not the gospel.
Yeah.
And we come from a long line of standards.
Yeah.
Yeah. We've been knowing right from wrong for a long time.
Yeah.
So let me say, if you be instant in season
yeah.
and out of season, reprove. Correct those who are wrong.
Yeah.
Rebuke and tell them to chastise them.
Yeah.
And then use this other word, exhort.
Yes.
You can do a lot by encouraging people.
Yeah.
Boy, can you encourage people. When you encourage people,
uh-huh.
people will light up.
Uh-huh.
One of the least used tools in our ministry
mm.
is the tool of exhortation.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Exhortation is, go, team, go. You know how to do that?
Uh-huh.
Run, team, one.
Uh-huh.
Win, team, win. Say that. How you feeling? Oh, I feel so bad. Well, I hope you have a good evening. Goodbye. We don't encourage. We don't encourage. Better than we tell them every night, take some 5x3½ cards and write some encouraging words and go give it to someone. Because during the week, those same words can edify, they can enlist, they can enliven, they can inspire. But we are so down.
So down.
God, I help you do all right. I pray for you. That ain't gonna hit. Exhort means to encourage.
Yeah.
When that football team is on fourth and one on the goal line, and you're trying to run them through the line, they're gonna say, go, go, go. You're gonna hear, give some noise in the place. And we sit up there, I hope you make it. We gotta exhort. Exhort. We are three traffic lights from the AT&T Center where my church is located, where the Spurs play. And they crowd that arena every time the Spurs play. And we see all the cars, everybody going in. And when you got in there, they'll have a little sign that says, make some noise.
Yeah.
And they don't say any kind, they say what kind of noise. Just make some noise. And the crowd, beer drinking and crazy as hell, they make all kind of noise.
Yeah.
We let the world outshine us when it comes to encounter. Because the same team that wins this year got to play again next year.
Yeah.
And if you don't repeat, then you just don't repeat.
Yeah.
But I know a man who won once and once and for all. He doesn't have to play next year because he went and he died. He died once and for all. His name is Jesus.
Yeah.
And he sits on high.
Yeah.
That's the one
that
I'm cheering for.
Yeah.
That's the one that gets me. That's the one that helps me walk and talk and do what I'm supposed to do. He's called.
Yeah.
And no other one can call me.
Yeah.
He is the Son of God, the living word.
Yeah.
Well, let me hurry on to my close.
Yeah.
It says, exalt with all long suffering.
Yeah.
Now, the next assignment is going to be when God calls you to the church.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
Now, don't say, I'm scared already.
Yeah.
They said, no, Jesus. But when you're ordained, you're ready to be called to the church.
Yes.
And God is going to use you. When you go there, they're going to welcome you nicely.
Mm-hmm.
And then you're going to have some strange folk there.
Mm-hmm.
Huh? You're going to have some agitators, prevaricators, mashpotatoes, commentators, take it back taters.
Mm-hmm.
And you're going to have to deal with people on a range you never thought you'd have to deal with.
Mm-hmm.
But the Lord says with long suffering.
Yeah.
You know what long suffering is? Long suffering is endurance.
Yeah.
Long suffering is the ability to stick to it.
Yeah.
And God wants you to stick to it. So when you get there and it gets tough, keep going.
Yeah.
Don't compromise. Don't try to get along just to get it to stay in.
Come on.
Stand on the word.
Yeah.
God brought you there, He can take you away.
Yeah.
God is over, He is the HRO.
Yeah.
He is over the human resource office. He moves and then He brings back. He reassigns. And only God can call you and only God can release you. Don't owe yourself to no man. So don't owe yourself to some deacon. I don't mean to pick on them, but like some one-eyed deacon somewhere that think they run the church. Y'all say amen right about that.
Amen.
The Bible says, let the people run the church. Amen. And the elders over them.
That's right.
Is that right?
Amen.
The board of directors, board of elders, and let the church be run as by the people.
Yeah.
No one person.
No one person
runs the church.
Amen.
Right now.
Amen.
Oh, no. Does that make
you
mad yet?
No.
I'll make you mad in a minute.
Yeah.
But no one person.
You're preaching, bitch.
Runs the church.
No one person.
So somebody who's taking too much on themselves, they're out of line. Now you don't have to go to them and fight them. Just pray them.
Yeah.
Let the peace work for you.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
So when you run into that, let the peace work for you. Now why are you going to do all this? He says, for the time will come when they will not endure.
Sound doctrine.
How we love fads. And we'll bring fads all the way into the church. Let me say this about fads. Fads have their time, but fads is not doctrine. Doctrine is the soundness of God's word. His word will stand now and forevermore. There's no equivocating with moral right. So you don't have to have rap music in the church to increase your attendance. It may think you have to do that to increase the attendance of young people. Just preach the word. They need the word. They don't know they need the word. Most young people don't know 10 commandments and couldn't name 10 commandments. If I put $100 bill here and ask them to name 10 commandments, most can't do it.
Yeah.
You want the 100, but you ain't gonna get it to you something. Is that right?
Yeah.
Am I talking to you?
Yeah.
So don't try to persuade them with gimmicks
that
don't work.
Yeah.
Jesus said, and the word of Paul said to Timothy, preach the word.
Preach the word.
And be instant in season and out of season, and preach and rebuke and reprove with all and exhort with all long suffering.
Uh-huh.
Because the time will come when they want to hit you. They'll pitch to themselves, attaching their teachers with itching ears.
Yeah.
Itching ears means, tell me what I want to hear. Don't tell me if I've been bad. Don't tell me if I'm going to hell. Don't tell me what I want to hear.
Right,
now when you get to the word, I want you to be ready to preach that word with authority,
with
persuasion, and having studied your word so that you know how to rightly divide the word of truth. It is important to tell the story. If you don't tell the story of Jesus and the cross, you haven't preached. If you talk about the radio, you talk about hip hop, you talk about rapping, and you talk about Beyonce and LL Cool J, that ain't the gospel. But when you preach the gospel,
you got to talk about the cross.
Yeah.
If you don't talk about it,
you
haven't preached. This is the gospel. The cross and Jesus crucified. The cross and Jesus resurrected from it's an old story. Somebody said it began. If you pick it up like one of the movies, say Passion of Christ, we'll start from the Garden of Gethsemane. Jesus finished the Passover, and in the midst of the Passover supper, he inaugurated the Lord's Supper. And he said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Then he gave him the wine and said, drink of eat all of it. This is my blood that is shed for you in the New Testament. And the Bible says, they all sang a song, and he went out into the garden. Now the garden was called Gethsemane, because it was the place of the olive press. Olives were taken and crushed and squeezed. They were crushed and squeezed, and the oil was used for medicinal purposes. Olive oil was used for medicine. Olive oil was used for cooking. Olive oil was used for trading on the economy. So Jesus was in the place of the olive press. Now what happened to him? He was going to be crushed and squeezed, just like the olives. But with his blood, we will be washed. With his stripes, we will be made whole. So he went into the garden, and there began to have his passion. And he told him to watch and pray with
him,
that he entered not into temptation. The Bible says he went a stone's throw and laid down prostrate on the ground. Meaning he laid down and began to pray. And Dr. Luke recalls that as he prayed, bloody drops of sweat came upon him. Now people have had a problem with that. But medical science will tell you that is a condition called hemotidrosis. The tiny capillaries in the sweat gland begin to burst under severe stress, under severe pressure. Jesus was going to become sin on this cross. Jesus was going to have God turn his back on him on this cross. And the thought of him becoming sin was too much for him. He began to crush under the grounds of the stress and bled bloody sweat. I was said, but the angel came and strengthened him. Whenever you go down, you're coming back up. Because when you go down, you're at your best place. And Jesus was down, but he was bleeding bloody sweat. And then
they came
with a group of rushing priests from the Sanhedrin, the guard. And they began to say, Judas had said, whomsoever I kiss, that is him, lay him fast and seize him. And they took Judas. Judas came up and kissed him and said, hell, master. And he said, Jesus said, betrayest thou me with a kiss?
Yeah.
And he kissed him anyway.
Yes, he did.
In the book of John, it said they went together, but Jesus just looked at him and they brought him around. They had to come back twice.
Yes, sir.
Just to hear Jesus.
Yes, sir. Yes,
because
sir.
Of who he was.
Yeah.
Just looking at him.
Yeah.
Made him drop to the ground.
Yeah.
Then they went and grabbed Jesus.
Yeah.
And they took him to the house of the high priest. They arrested him at night. The members of the Sanhedrin weren't part of the arresting party. They should have reclused themselves. They took him on and declared that he would stand trial at night. That was against Jewish law. Then they took him to Caiaphas, to Caiaphas' house. And then tried to say, tell us, are you not the Son of God? He wouldn't open his mouth. Then they took him on the next morning. They formulated the whole Sanhedrin. The Sanhedrin 71 members, and they all agreed that he was going to be tried for blasphemy.
He
said, tear down this temple and he'll build another one. He blasphemed the Holy Spirit. But something happened because they figured out for blasphemy they couldn't kill him because the Sanhedrin did not have the right for capital punishment. So they changed the charges. And made the charges sedition. He said he's the king, and we have only one king, Caesar. They did all of that. And Jesus just laughed at him. They beat him, they struck him, they had three three Jewish trials, three Roman trials, and the Romans found him not guilty, but the Jews found him guilty. His own brothers found him guilty. Just like Joseph's brothers sold him into slavery, Judas sold Jesus for 30 pieces of silver. And they couldn't find fault in him except they trumped up charges. When they trumped up charges, then they said, now we got him. Pontius Pilate, aware of the fact that they was obviously trying to crucify him because they were jealous. But for jealousy, they delivered him. And so he knew that on the Passover, that was this kind of thing where you release one. And so he asked him, who me that I release? And they said, release in the house. Barabbas. Barabbas was a murderer. Barabbas deserved to die. And then Pontius Pilate, but what shall we do with this one that is called Jesus? And the crowd said, crucify him. And they took out Jesus. And they prepared for crucifixion. The first thing they did, go with me as we walk down that aisle. Go with me as we go down Via Dolorosa from the Praetorian prison of the fortress Antonia to Golgotha. Go with me now. They would first strip him of his clothing, raise his hands above his head, tie his hands, and then the Roman legionnaire would take a flagellum. A flagellum is a small whip that had bits of tar, bits of leather, bits of metal ball, even had bones on it, and it also had fissures. It wasn't a long whip. It was just a short little whip. And the legionnaire would get back with that whip that was so heavy, lean back and whip Jesus and then pull him. He wouldn't be like a whip that you whip a bull whip with. He just hit like that. He would whip and bring that thing back. The hooks would pull off the flesh off the back of Jesus. The first 10 flesh lashes would take off the epidermal tissue. The second 10 will take off the muscle. The third 10 will get to the capillaries. And then when you got to the ninth 39 lashes, you could see the white of his backbone of his spine. His flesh was hanging off his buttocks like ribbon. And they beat my Jesus till he was an inch away from death. Then they took the crossbar of the cross. The crossbar is called the patibulum. The patibulum weighed 75 to 125 pounds. They took the splintered patibulum and put it on his back and made him go down Via Dolorosa 650 yards till he got to Golgotha. He'd been up all night. He was bruised. He was battered. He was dehydrated. And he was almost ready to go into shock. And as he was carrying this baby, he fell down under the weight of him. And somebody asked the question, must Jesus bear the cross alone and all the world go free? No, there is a cross for everyone. And there is a cross for me.
The gospel message. Yes, sir.
That was a black man. An African. From Northern Africa. By the name of Simon of Cyrene. They pressed him into service and said, help Jesus carry the patibulum. And he carried the patibulum with Jesus all the way up 650 yards down Via Dolorosa, the street of sorrows, up to Golgotha. And when they got there, they were ready to crucify. The Romans had studied crucifixion. The Persians invented the cross, as it was. And then you had Alexander the Great bringing the cross back as a tool of torture to the Mediterranean. Then the Carthaginians, a group of people from whom the Phoenicians had, were the earlier descendants, black people who gave us our phonetic alphabet. They had the cross. And then when Rome conquered the Carthaginians, they perfected the cross into a methodical killing machine. Well, how did it work? Let me tell you how it worked. They would take a man and beat him to an inch of his life. The idea of the cross was to inflict so much suffering that it would make a man want to die. If they killed him quickly, they didn't have the pleasure of watching him die. So the purpose of their cross was a slow, agonizing, methodical, excruciating death. And the word excruciates means out of, cruciate, the cross. When you have excruciating pain, it is pain from out of the cross. And so they took Jesus. And they took those nails, 8-inch nails. They reached for the ulna, the bone that is between the wrist and the hand. And they drove an 8-inch nail, boom, boom, into the flesh and drove it into the wood. The reason why they put it there is because when the nail went up against the ulna of the bone, it wouldn't, the weight of the body wouldn't pull the body off. They had to get that bone strategic, and the nail was in front. front of the bone, so that when the bone took the weight of the body, it would stay there. So they ran to the other side, and they drove a square inch, 8-inch nail into his hand, and they beat it in. Then they took the legs and flexed them at a 45-degree angle. They put the right over the left. They pointed the toes down, and they took a nail and drove that nail through the metatarsal of the bone, and sending waves of pain through the sciatic nerve. And Jesus, when he wanted to breathe, had to go on his legs and feel the pain of the nail. When he had to slump down, he had the weight of the body and the nails on his hand. And that was relentless, spasmatic cramps that started in his fingers, ran through his arms, exploded in his head. But the first thing out of his mouth wouldn't get me down. But he said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not how they did." And Jesus said, and he was there for 3 hours. And the first hour, his shoulders were out of joint, which means his hands were extended. Had he come down off the cross, his hands and arms would have been like a orangutan, 9 to 6 inches longer. They whipped Jesus.
They whipped him.
And they beat him. And then they took those 2-inch Palestinian thorns and wrapped them around and put them on the head and took the stick that was in his hand and separated and crushed them down. And blood did run down. And then as Jesus began, he was trying to breathe. It was hard for him to breathe. And the whole purpose of the cross was to die by asphyxiation. Carbon dioxide would be in your body. Carbon dioxide, you need to exhale. But it was hard for him to exhale. So he would push himself up on his hurting legs and try to breathe. And it was hurting. But he could only say, "Father, into thy hands do I commit my spirit." And he gave up the ghost. He went through that pain. He went through that suffering. You've got to tell the story that Jesus went through that. And when the carbon dioxide built up, the heart began to pump harder because the blood was thick. And as it built up, the heart kept on pumping and kept on pumping until it exploded. Jesus did not die of asphyxiation. He died of a broken heart. And they took him off that cross when he died. They took a sheet and climbed up on the backside of the cross, ran the sheet under his shoulders, tied it around, and pulled the nails out and lowered his body down gently. Then they pulled the nails out of the feet and they took him on to a barge. They took him on to a garden that was near the Calvary. What had been lost in the Garden of Eden would be taken back in the garden called Calvary. There was a garden in Calvary, and that garden was where the sepulchre of Joseph of Arimathea was. They put his body in a borrowed tomb, a brand new tomb, and the Bible said he would rise on the third day. He told them that just like Noah was in the belly of the whale, so will I be in the middle of the earth. 3 days. And 3 nights. What he's saying, he just didn't go to the grave. His soul went to hell. You better get the rest of the soul. We buried him and we don't take him to hell. But Acts 2 and 31 said, he was his body did not remain. His soul did not remain in hell. The only way you can remain somewhere is you got to get there first. In Ephesians 4:19, he said, "He that descended, ascended, but first descended." Descended means to go down. What are you saying, Reverend Benson? 14,000 miles under your feet is the earth's core. There is the mantle, the core, and the submantle, and then the actual core. You have 14,000 miles. So that's why when people dream they're falling, they got a 14,000 mile drop in the spirit all the way to the pit of hell. Bible says Jesus went to hell and preached to them there. He told them, "You know why you're here? Because you didn't accept the word. You know why you're here? You didn't accept my word. You didn't accept my provision. I became the sacrifice. When I put those nails were put in my hand. That was 4 or 5 wounds in my body. The 5 wounds represents all of those sacrifices that would be offered. First the bullock, then the oxen, then the lamb, then the goat, and the pigeon and turtle doves. Jesus was the one and perfect sacrifice who died for all sins forever. And he told the soldier, "You're here because you didn't accept my father's provision. You're here because you didn't accept the word. And my Bible tell me, can I say it now?
Yeah.
He was there all night Friday night.
Yeah.
All night Saturday.
Yeah.
But